Magazine, and I'm here in Cincinnati to do the Heads-Feds debate against former DEA Special Agent Bob Stutman, who was the head of the New York DEA office at the same time I was editor-in-chief of High Times.
How long were you the editor there at High Times?
Oh, about 15, 16 years. Now I live in Woodstock, New York, and I write a column for High Times, and I travel around the country trying to raise consciousness about the value of the cannabis plant by students. I think people in college should concentrate on their education and not be involved with binge drinking or breakfast bong hits. But at the same time, I think the war on drugs is a terrible, terrible waste of money and resources. And I think there's a lot of benefits and enhancement that marijuana offers adults who want to use it responsibly.
How long you been in the movement to legalize marijuana?
It's funny, you know, I went to Woodstock when I was about 17 years old. And, I thought marijuana was going to be legal in a few years, in 1969. And I was never really a big marijuana smoker or user until I came to High Times. And I just sort of always offered a job at High Times, and I took it, even though I wasn't really, you know, I wouldn't turn down marijuana if somebody offered to me at a party, but I never went out of my way to get it. I never, you know, I never was a daily user or anything like that, and I never, you know, for me it was like a waste of money usually, you know what I mean? I didn't want to spend the money, you know, so.
Pretty cheap back in those days, wasn't it?
No. In the 80s in New York City, it was getting pretty expensive. I mean, in 1969, it was you could buy an ounce for $20, you know, Mexican. But those days are over, you know. But I was really surprised. I didn't know anything about marijuana. I knew I liked it, so I figured it must be bad for you, like alcohol. And it was only after I was at the magazine for a few years and I was studying the plant that I began to realize that the real, the so-called health risks were way, way, way exaggerated, and that the benefits were just being ignored, especially the medical benefits. So I encourage students to get involved in the legalization movement.
So why do you think it is illegal? What's the reasoning behind it?
Well, the legal drug industry doesn't want to, because they can't control the means of production. Anybody can grow it anywhere, and, you know, so you can't establish a cartel and fix prices and gouge people and have a monopoly like they do with sugar and oil and gasoline and, you know, and everything else, diamonds, and you know what I mean? They can't control
it.
So they don't want it around, you know what I mean? So they'd like to see it exterminated off the face of the earth if they could, which is really sad because it's probably the most beneficial plant on the planet.
Not just for medical, what about like industrial hemp?
Exactly. Well, that's what we need right now. We need biofuels because, the price point's going to happen real soon. It's going to be cheaper to produce biodiesel than it is to buy diesel. We're almost there now. You know, when gasoline hits $7, $8, $9 a gallon, biofuel is going to have to be looked at seriously. 5 years when we started out, we were very antagonistic towards each other and didn't know. The first time we met, we were on stage and had a big argument. I thought he was going to slug me. And after about four or five of the debates, we actually began to respect each other, and we're actually good friends now. A lot of people are very amazed by this, but I actually think Bob's one of the more enlightened DEA people in the world, and he's turned down the drug czar job. I wish he'd taken it, although my endorsement won't do anything for him. But you know, he's in favor of medical marijuana. He understands it's important as medicine, and he's not anti-hemp, and you know, he has his reasons why he thinks it's better off to keep it illegal, and I don't agree with him. But at the same time, we respect each other, and we don't attack each other personally, even though we argue the issues very passionately.
How long y'all been to Dayton?
5 years. Yeah, we do about 10 a semester.
You travel the country.
Yeah, a lot of motels and a lot of bad chain food.
You're with the DEA?
No, I'm not. I was.
You got your retired.
Right.
You had a chance to be the drug czar after you that job?
I can't comment on that publicly. My conversations with other politicians are not for public.
Oh, okay. So why do you think marijuana should be illegal?
All marijuana or medical marijuana? What are we talking about?
All marijuana.
Yeah, because I think it is a drug that is generally used for recreational intoxicating purposes, the same way we have alcohol. We have a terrible problem with alcohol in the United States. And I don't think the country wants to accept another recreational drug that will add to the problems of alcohol and tobacco. Because we don't need it. We've already got plenty of problems, and we simply don't need to add another one. There are 170 million users of alcohol. There are 14 million users of marijuana. Those figures don't fall out that way by accident.
What are the problems with marijuana? No one dies from marijuana.
Well, that's...
Many die from alcohol.
Yeah, that's...
It's like medical marijuana. 100 people a year.
You know, we got to talk about one thing. What are we talking about? Are we talking about marijuana or medical marijuana?
Oh, any of these.
Well, on the medical marijuana issue, I think public voting on what is a good medicine is a stupid policy. The public should not make decisions on medicine based on advertising, marketing, or good speakers on either side of the issue. Scientists and doctors should make the decision on what is or isn't good medicine, number one. And the day the scientists and physicians say marijuana is a good medicine, I accept that. Secondly, I truly believe that two of the components of marijuana, delta-9-THC and cannabidol, probably do have good medical properties. I just think it is, again, incredibly foolish to say you have to smoke 433 other chemicals along with those two in order to get the medical benefit of those two. If those two are good medicine, we extract them, take the pure chemicals, and allow people to use them under proper medical supervision.
Well, you can more or less do that with a vaporizer.
You can't control the strength of the drug. Nobody has any idea the strength of the drug when they pop it in a vaporizer. It can be 0.5%, it can be 10% delta-9. You can't tell by looking at, smelling it, and if you think you can trust your dealer, then you're a bigger fool than I think you are. Well, that's what you say. I guess I would say simply nobody knows for sure, because so few people are actually tested. People have certainly died in accidents from marijuana. There are 4 cases going on in state Supreme Courts right now tying intoxication of marijuana to automobile accidents. People do not overdose from marijuana, if that's what you mean. And I completely agree with that. But people don't overdose from tobacco either. It takes 20 years of regular tobacco use to develop any of the negative consequences from tobacco. And there are a number of studies done in Europe, not the United States, that show that marijuana is probably tied to throat, mouth, and lung cancer.
It seems 100 people a year die from aspirin use. No one dies from marijuana use. Why?
Well, you keep repeating. You keep repeating what you want to repeat. I never argue with a guy who's got the camera, because I know you edit and you end up. So why am I going to argue with you? You keep repeating what you want to repeat. I understand what you're saying. I guess I will tell you that there are a whole bunch of very respected physicians and medical groups many of whom were based in Europe where marijuana is legal, the Mayo Clinic, the British Journal of Pharmacology, that all tie smoking marijuana to lung, throat, and mouth cancer. One of the experts at my friend Steve Hagar advocates Mitch Earlywine in his book in a number of places says smoking marijuana indeed may be causing lung, throat, and mouth cancer. So I think it is a bad habit for kids to use. And furthermore, I think a doctor, and I'm not a physician, but a doctor who tells you to smoke something for your health is a fool.
Hey, when you were in New York, you had a run-in with John Gotti?
I didn't have any run-in with him. Mr. Gotti and I are acquaintances. we didn't have a run-in. We had a conversation. I never have a run-in with a man who carries more guns than I do.
About right.
Okay.
Okay. Appreciate it.
All right.
The DEA guy?
New York City police.
Who's there?
He's the bald-headed one.
Oh, I thought he worked for the DEA. Entire DEA.
I thought so too.
What did you just told me?
He did work for the DEA?
Yeah. He got off with the drug dealer's job.
Good for him.
Hell, I was trying to do it. He's probably better than me.
Very gentrified town now. In those days, just a poor mill town. My father was an electrician, grew up in a classic middle-class home. After graduating high school, I went to Providence College. I was planning to get my master's degree in business, and about 6 months before I graduated, the dean of students called me up and he said, Bob, would you come up to the office? And I went up and he said, would you like to be interviewed by the CIA for a job with them? And I said, well, how come me? And he said he had no idea CIA picked out people who had requested to be interviewed. Ended up going down to Langley, took a whole host of interviews with CIA, and I had great visions of being James Bond. I can't sit behind a desk. So because I was in Washington, I decided I'd go out and interview with the FBI, Secret Service, and DEA predecessor at that time. And I'll never forget saying, you know, I think I'd really like to go with DEA because those guys seem crazy. I was a street agent and a supervisor with DEA for about 17 years. And then one day I was at my sister's house on 4th of July, and the director of DEA called me up and said, Bob, you're doing a hell of a job. We're going to move you. You got a choice of agent in charge of either Miami or New York. When I was transferred to New York as agent in charge, it began probably the most exciting piece of my life. This city, if you're in drug enforcement, is clearly the most exciting city in the world. And while it was the most difficult work I ever did, it's the most fun I ever had. Well, I was in New York about 3 weeks, and my life changed. An agent, one of my senior supervisors, walked in and he said, Boss, we've been finding vials of this shit all over Harlem, and they call it crack, and we don't know anything about it. In September, almost no one in New York ever heard of crack.
Did you bring some?
Yes, I did.
Yes, please.
Can I trust you? I got a call from my deputy, Kevin Gallagher, about 11:30 at night. I was in bed, and I'll never forget his words. He said, Bob, this is Kevin, Everett Hatcher has been shot dead. He was shot working undercover, assassinated from behind. Well, what happened, we found out later, was Gus Faraci became suspicious of Everett Hatcher. He simply walked up behind him, put four bullets in his head. That night, I did a press conference. Everybody who thinks doing a line of coke
is a joke and doesn't hurt anybody, or to take a look at the body of this family man who has four kids and died trying to deal with those lines of coke that so many New York yuppies think is nothing. And apparently the president saw it, President Bush, and he was moved by it, and he called me and said he would like to come up to New York and visit with the widow of Everett Hatcher and the DEA agent.
Ladies and gentlemen, our Commander-in-Chief, the President, George Bush.
Finally, I had enough, and one morning I called my deputy at 6 o'clock in the morning and said, Kevin, I'm going to go see John Gotti. And nobody else could know about it because it violated every rule in the book. He said, you sure you want to do this? I said, yeah, but if I don't come back, at least you know where I am. I went up to Howard Beach and I knocked on John Gotti's door. He came down and it was amazing to me, 6:30 in the morning, his hair was combed and he was wearing a bathrobe that probably cost more money than my suit. And he said, what can I do for you? I said, John, you know our guy was killed and you know Gus did it. He said, yes, and I'm sorry for that. I said, John, I need him handed over to me, or your business is stopped. Do you understand, John? He said, yes, I understand. Thank you very much. And we each turned around and walked away. 17 days later, I got a call from one of our agents, and he said, Bob, I think we've got Gus Faraci. Gus Faraci was laying on the street corner in Brooklyn with 17 bullet holes in him. That was the end of Gus. Some of the New York papers said I was a hero. Some said, who was I to play judge and jury? But I was never going to allow a DEA agent to be assassinated and the person who did it get away with it.
Small town in Illinois, a university town called Champaign-Urbana. At that time, I was being raised in the Lutheran faith and was going to Saturday school and Sunday school. And I got to talk to the pastor one day and I asked him what was going to happen to all the Jews and the Buddhists and the people in Africa. And he told me they were all going to hell. I went home and I told my parents I wouldn't go back to that church anymore. Because in my heart, I could not believe what that guy was saying. And I entered Urbana High School in 1966 at the age of 15. After I kind of lost faith in Christianity, I was looking for something, and I was reading all these books, books by Jack Kerouac and Ken Kesey, and I think the most important book was probably Tom Wolfe's account of Ken Kesey and the Merry Pranksters. I ended up going to San Francisco, and LSD was unheard of in Champaign-Urbana. So me and my friends, we became the first people in our high school to actually take LSD and smoke marijuana. Newspaper called the Tin Whistle, which just got bigger and bigger every month till it was being distributed in four high schools in my area, and it was banned in every single one of them. I ended up reading the first book about the Kennedy assassination. It was called Rush to Judgment. And after reading that book, I pretty much concluded that the CIA was involved somehow in the assassination. And I became a Hamlet figure and spent the next 30 years trying to figure out who was really running the country. I was working as a reporter for the New York Daily News when I started covering the art scene. I really didn't know anything about graffiti. I wasn't a native New Yorker. I didn't know the history of it or anything. I'd been through this whole underground, hippie, beatnik, psychedelic movement with garage rock, and we were doing our own publications and our own bands and making up our own culture. Well, at the same time, inner city blacks in the South Bronx were doing a very similar thing. After I got hired by High Times, the first big story I did was to go to Amsterdam to interview the founder of the Seed Bank, a man named Neville, who had created a multi-million dollar operation by shipping high-quality cannabis seeds around the world. While I was out there working on the story, I ran into some Americans who told me about the harvest festivals that had been held in Northern California in the early 70s. And it gave me the idea of trying to have a similar harvest festival in Amsterdam legally, where we could establish a worldwide standard for cannabis. I didn't know very much about marijuana when I came to High Times. It was only after I read Jack Rear's book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes, that I got a sense of the tremendous political and spiritual implications that the plant carried with it.
Cannabis is an annually renewable, farmable crop. All of it for fiber, most of the fiber, and 100% of the fuel from that.
And I think it was the knowledge of the environmental benefits of hemp that really helped drive me to my first national rainbow gathering. You can investigate who's behind 911 and the global system of banking and military that manufactures war for profit. But don't forget, the culture you create is much more important. Don't think culture is something you buy in a box or watch on television. It's actually the ceremonies that you and your tribe create. Jump out of the box and start creating your own culture.
In 1985, Robert M. Stutman was put in charge of the DEA's largest office in New York City. He put together a team of agents that led the fight against the crack epidemic. His best-selling book, Dead on Delivery, was made into a made-for-TV movie. He is a consultant to CBS News and has been called the most famous narc in America. In 1988, Stephen Hagar was put in charge of High Times magazine, the leading counterculture publication in America. His book, Hip Hop, had just been published, the first history of rap, graffiti, and breaking. His research was turned into the film, Beat Street. While at High Times, Hagar created the Cannabis Cup and the Counterculture Hall of Fame. He has been called the most famous pothead in America. Now they meet in person. Hagar versus Stutman. The head versus the fed.
I want to thank the student lecture group for bringing Bob and I here today to talk about this very important topic. I'm going to give you five reasons tonight why I think marijuana should be legal. And the first reason is because it's good medicine. Good for AIDS, cancer, glaucoma, epilepsy, strokes, asthma, head injuries, multiple sclerosis. You know, I could keep going. And going and going, because there's more diseases and disorders for which this is a useful treatment than any other substance under the sun. And I didn't say it was going to cure cancer, people, but I know people who can see today because they use marijuana as medicine. And I know people who can walk because they use marijuana as medicine. And I know people who are alive because they use marijuana as medicine. And let's not forget, officially, according to the United States government, marijuana is Schedule 1. You know what that means? It means it has absolutely no medical value whatsoever. And that is the equivalent of standing in a raging hurricane and have the United States government tell you the wind ain't blowing. It is symptomatic of our healthcare system, in my opinion. And I think our healthcare system is broken.
The costs for health care in this country have been skyrocketing while our actual health care has been diminishing in quality. You know, we have created a health care system that funnels billions of dollars in profit to two major entities, insurance companies and pharmaceutical companies. And I'm not talking about money that goes into research, people. I'm talking these are the most profit-intensive industries in America. We didn't have to create a healthcare system like this, but this is the system we have. And we have millions of people that have no hope of ever getting healthcare insurance. We have employers that don't want to create jobs now because they don't want to pay the premiums on healthcare insurance. And, you know, this system we have, they don't have a problem with anybody getting high, really. You're not feeling good? You want to elevate your mood? Just go to the student healthcare center here and tell them you're not feeling well. They have lots of drugs for you. Paxil, Prozac, Lovox, Zoloft. They're handing this stuff out to kids like M&Ms. And I don't mean to disturb anybody here because I know most people now are on these substances. And you're going to be on these substances for a long, long time. They're going to be moving you from one analog to the next. And the reality is that a lot of these substances that they want you to take are less effective and have worse side effects than marijuana. But they own the patents on them. And they're going to keep collecting their $150, $200 a week off you for a long time. And the problem that this system has with marijuana is when I hand you a seeded marijuana flower, I'm handing you and your future generations free medicine for the rest of your lives. Just take a seed out of that flower, put it in a flower pot, put it in a windowsill, put it in a balcony, put it in a front yard, put it in a backyard, put it anywhere from Maine to Texas, from Florida to Alaska, from the Arctic Circle to the equator, outgrows everything under the sun, and you have free medicine. You think maybe that has something to do with why they don't recognize the importance of this medicine? Second reason I like to see marijuana legal is because hemp is good for the environment. Now, when this country was founded, it was not called marijuana. Marijuana was a term that they brought into being during Reefer Madness in the 30s because against marijuana were steeped in racism. But they didn't tell you that George Washington and Thomas Jefferson were hemp farmers, that George Washington advised the American farmer was make the most of hemp seed, grow it everywhere. They didn't tell you that every ship that sailed the sea was rigged in tons of marijuana sails and rope. And when Master and Commander wrote in his logbook late at night, that was a marijuana seed oil lamp that illuminated his log. They didn't tell you that every prairie schooner that crossed the West was covered in marijuana. They didn't tell you that the soldiers at Valley Forge all wore clothes made out of marijuana. They didn't even tell you that you could pay your taxes in raw hemp stock when this country was founded because they wanted every farmer in America to grow this plant. It was important to national security. Now, when they made this plant illegal, there were over 20,000 different things being made out of it. And I look around today, and all 20,000 of those things are made from petrochemicals, major cause of world pollution. Now, in 1917, they knew, let me just give you one example of one of those 20,000 things. They knew in 1917 they could produce four times as much paper on an acre of hemp as they could with an acre of trees over a 20-year period. Yet, we've deforested half of North America to make cheap paper out of trees. It's a bad product. Paper mills are number one cause of river pollution in America. All of our tree pulp paper is contaminated with dioxin, the most carcinogenous substance known to man. The paper is bad paper. It doesn't last very long, one generation. The Gutenberg Bibles were all printed on hemp paper. That's why they're still around. So, did we have to deforest half of North America to pump dioxin into our water to give our grandkids cancer? Now, you extrapolate that to 20,000 different things, everything from paints, varnishes, clothing, fuels, dynamite, plastics. Maybe you're seeing the impact of what I'm talking about, of moving from a petrochemical-based society to a natural, renewable, non-toxic-based society. And people, we have to make this change. And the sooner we recognize this and start cleaning up the mess that's been created by these petrochemicals. The third reason I like to see marijuana legalized is because we've created the biggest prison system in the world in my lifetime in America. When I was in high school, we had a couple hundred thousand people in all the jails and prisons in America. Do you know how many people we have in prison in America today? Over 2 million. You know? And going to prison is a lot worse for you than smoking a joint. You take somebody who's growing marijuana, maybe they have multiple sclerosis and they have to survive, or maybe they just want to get high. Government makes no distinction. You're going to go to jail for mandatory minimum sentences that do not exist for violent criminals. Rapists or armed robbers don't have mandatory minimum sentences. You're going to lose your house and your car and your bank account to forfeiture. They don't have forfeiture for violent criminals, but they have it for people that grow marijuana. You're going to lose your profession. You're going to be locked in a cage with violent psychopaths, and then after 15 years, they're going to let you out. And you think these people are rehabilitated? No, they're not rehabilitated. They're destroyed. They have no home. Their kids are in foster care. They have no profession. Their lives are in turmoil, and they've spent years in a cage with psychopaths, and all they know now is how to be a criminal. So locking up 2 million people is not a solution, people, because they're all getting out of jail. And now they're a bigger problem when they get out of jail. So we have to stop thinking that locking people in jail is a solution to substance abuse. It's not. Anybody who has a problem with substance abuse belongs in a hospital or under the care and guidance of healthcare professionals. Law enforcement should not be involved. Fourth reason I think marijuana should be legal is because we've got to stop funding corruption. You know, we have an organized crime system in the United States today that was created through alcohol prohibition. And they're still around today, but they got their foothold in this country through alcohol prohibition. Now, there's $500 billion floating around the world with illegal drugs. Suppose you had $500 billion a year, tax-free money, for 20 years. What would you own? What wouldn't you own? You'd own General Motors. You'd own generals in the Pentagon. You'd own small Latin American countries, and they do. And I don't mean to cast any aspersions on Mr. Stutman here, who I respect, or any of the other law enforcement officials here who I do respect, and they are our public servants, and they deserve our respect, and these laws are not their fault, and please don't blame them. They are trapped in this madness just like we are. But we have to understand, people, the real price of marijuana is not $5,000 a pound. It's cheaper to produce than corn or soybeans or wheat. It's the cheapest commodity to produce on the face of the earth. The real price of marijuana is $1 a pound. And we give $4,999 to criminals to build criminal cartels and corrupt our system, and they do. And even if we stop doing it now, we're going to live with these criminal cartels for the rest of our lives and our grandchildren's lives, but we have to stop funding them at some point and realize that the way to stop funding them is to allow adults legitimate, reasonable access. Finally, the last reason I like to see marijuana legalized is the most important reason for me personally, but it's the hardest reason for me to talk about. It's part of my culture. Ran away and went to Woodstock. And I landed in a field with 500,000 people like me, and we called each other brother and sister. We shared everything. And every year since Woodstock, there's been an event in the United States called the National Rainbow Family Gathering, held in a high mountain meadow in a different state every year. 30,000 people gather, people from all persuasions, religious backgrounds. Everyone's invited to this event. And no money's allowed. Everything is free. All the food is free. All the health care is free. And we built a little echo village for a week and we disappeared. And on July 4th, we all hold hands and pray for world peace. Doesn't seem like such a bad thing, does it really? And yet, when my family's on the way to the gathering, we got to run through a phalanx. State narcotics agents, DEA, local law enforcement. My kids got to watch me get dragged out of the car while they put the drug dogs on me. Is this the way to treat people on their way to a prayer circle? And this is the type of bigotry that has been inflicted on my culture my entire life. And I'm not proselytizing people. I don't care what you think about it. I don't want you to run off and join the Rainbow Family, whatever, but I would like you to understand, we're good people. We don't allow alcohol in our ceremonies. We don't allow violence or weapons in our ceremonies. But we do allow cannabis because we believe it is our sacrament. And this is a deep-seated belief that isn't going to go away. And you know, my culture's done a lot of good things for America. We're not going to take over America. We're not going to turn the joint chiefs into the joint smoking chiefs. But we're an important vitamin for America. We're as American as apple pie. We deserve to be here. The earth wants us here. We created the midwife movement in America. We created vegan vegetarian lifestyles in America. We helped create the environmental movement in America. We can do good things for America, and we have, but we could do a lot better if we weren't so persecuted through these laws. So please, can I get a little freedom of religion in America? Thank you.
The university and the Friday night group and for having us here, so many of you guys coming out. I don't care what side of the issue you're on. Steve and I both appreciate a fair, polite hearing, and so we can all think about the issue. Let me tell you what I think is the most important thing I'm going to say tonight, and it has nothing to do with drugs and marijuana. As you probably saw from the short DVD introduction, Steve and I come from very different places. We have different backgrounds. We believe in some different things. We look very different. In about 10 seconds, you will see me attack Steve very strongly on the issues. And you will see him attack me on the issues. But you will never see us attack each other personally. You will never see us disrespect each other, because despite the fact he and I are so different, Steve and I are good personal friends. And I think that standard of being able to honestly disagree about an issue and not becoming personal and not becoming the enemy because you happen to disagree with somebody else is an incredibly important standard for all of us to hold up in this crazy world today. And hopefully we can set that standard for you tonight. Having said those nice things about Steve, let me start off by pointing out that Steve is so smart. That's why he's one of my very good friends. He's an incredibly good speaker and a debater. Steve just did something very, very slick. First of all, he ignored Patrick Henry's original rule of debating. Patrick Henry, who founded American debating, said about 200 years ago, in America, everybody's entitled to their own opinion, which is absolutely true. But not everybody is entitled to their own facts. And what my friend Steve has just done very artfully for 15 minutes was present his opinion about issues as fact. And because some of you like what he had to say, you take it in as fact and don't challenge it. My challenge to you tonight is hold me to a standard where you're going to expect me to tell you the truth and be factual. I expect that. But do the same thing to Steve. Just because you like what he says, don't give him a free ride. Let me give you a couple of examples of a couple of the things Steve said tonight that were stretching the truth a little. Steve said marijuana will never be approved by the FDA, will never become an approved drug. Why? Because it's not synthetic. If it's not synthetic, if they can't make it and own the patent, they're not going to approve it. You all heard him say that. I guess Steve forgot that the single largest source of revenue for the pharmaceutical companies in the United States over the past 50 years was a drug called penicillin, a natural extract of the mold on the rye plant. I guess Steve forgot that the single largest drug prescribed for any woman that comes down with breast cancer is a drug called tamoxifen. A natural extract, almost do nothing to it. They extract it from plants grown in Latin America. And I guess Steve did not read USA Today about 4 weeks ago when it was pointed out that about 6 months ago, the FDA approved a new medical device, a synthetic maggots, were approved for use in open wounds and sores by the Food and Drug Administration. So how can Steve stand there and tell us it's only synthetics that they approve? Steve has done something very artful tonight. He has redefined the debate. What do I mean by that? Well, some people accuse the present Bush administration of redefining the debate. Why did you go to war in Iraq? Weapons of mass destruction. Well, there weren't any. Well, it was tied to 9-1-1. I'm sorry, it wasn't. Well, it'll give us peace in the Middle East. Well, no, it didn't. That's what some people call redefining the debate. Steve Hagar just did the same thing. He just gave you five very intellectual-sounding reasons why marijuana should be legalized. He never once mentioned the main reason why most people who are in favor of legal marijuana want it made legal. I will argue with you that most people who want marijuana legal do not give a damn about hemp, medical marijuana, cultural issues, or religious rights. You know why they want it made legal? Because it's my drug of choice, and I want to be able to use it to get high, and I don't want the cops hassling me. Well, how come Steve never mentioned that? How come he gave you all these intellectual-sounding arguments? Because he knows the American public will not buy another recreational drug of choice when we have so much problems with the ones we already have. Now let's take a look at the arguments Steve did use. Let me very quickly go over a couple of them. Steve told you marijuana is natural, therefore it must be good. If God made it, it's got to be good. I guess Steve forgot the first 11 months of the Bush administration, the single largest ecological argument. You guys all remember it. Remember what it was? How much arsenic do we allow in the drinking water? Now you're all bright young men and women. You know arsenic can kill you. Too much in the drinking water will kill you. Guess what? Arsenic is not man-made. It is not a synthetic. It flows up from the bottom of the riverbeds and embeds itself into the reservoirs. Just because God made something doesn't necessarily make it good for you and I. Steve told you that marijuana is great medicine. Says who, Dr. Steve? We do not decide what is good medicine in the United States by putting up to popular vote. We allow scientists and doctors to make rational scientific decisions. If Steve were being honest with you, let me tell you what he should have said. I absolutely agree with this. That two of the chemicals in marijuana, Delta-9 THC and CBL, are probably good medicine for some diseases. I completely agree with that. But Steve will then go on to tell you, in order to get the medicinal effect of those two chemicals, we got to smoke a weed that has 433 other chemicals mixed in with it in order to get the two good ones. Does that sound like medicine, or does that sound like a cultural issue? Now, what about all of these states that vote on whether something is good medicine or not? Shouldn't we allow people to vote on whether they want to take something as medicine? Let me tell you something, guys. There are lots of stupid policies on both of our sides of the issue. I don't work for the government anymore. I haven't worked for the government for 10 years. There are lots of stupid policies on my side of the issue. I'll tell you one. I do not think anybody should be thrown in prison for the use of any drug. I think that is a stupid policy, a waste of government priorities, etc. And I'm the first one to tell you that. But let me tell you what is just as stupid a policy. Putting up to popular vote whether or not something should be a good medicine. This decision should not be made based on who's a better speaker or an advertising campaign. It should be made by professional doctors and scientists. Let me give you an example. Suppose Monday you came down with a bad cough, and you went to the doctor here at University of Cincinnati, and she said to you, you know, Bob, You do have bronchitis. You got a pretty bad case of bronchitis, but I'm not sure if I should give you tetracycline or penicillin. Let's put it up to a vote of the students at University of Cincinnati and see what they think. I'll bet you'd never go back to that doctor again. That's not how we make good public policy. And finally, on this issue, I am certainly not a physician. There may be some doctors and nurses in the audience, and if there are, I don't mean to step on your toes. But I know this, any doctor who tells you to smoke something for your health is a fool. Then Steve told you that hemp is the greatest thing in the world since Master and Commander Thomas Jefferson and George Washington. I am not an anti-hempist, guys. That's not the issue I'm debating tonight. I truly have nothing against hemp. But I do know one basic thing. My undergraduate degree was in economics. One of the things I learned, anybody in business school knows this, if somebody produces a product that is perceived by the public to be worthwhile, you can sell the hell out of that product. I always ask myself a very simple question. If hemp is as good as my friend Steve says it is, how come in Europe, where hemp has been legal for 50 years, there are no laws in Europe against hemp. You can buy hemp plants, hemp clothes, hemp oil. How come everybody in Europe wears cotton wool just like we do? How come they don't all walk around in hemp clothes? How come they don't use hemp oil? How come they don't use hemp paper where it's absolutely legal? Obviously, it's either not as good as Steve says it is, or it's so expensive that the public perceives that the worth isn't there. And then finally, Steve used his killer argument. I do it in the name of religion, therefore it's my right. If you do it in the name of religion, you can do it. Well, I guess my friend Steve never heard of the Church of Latter-day Saints, the Mormons, who until the middle of the 19th century, utilized polygamy as one of the sacraments of their church, until the majority of Americans in the court said, you're not going to do it anymore, then the elders of the church banned polygamy in the Mormon church. Just because you do it in the name of religion does not necessarily make it right. I do not believe marijuana should be made legal for one simple reason. I do not think it's the devil weed. I do not think it's evil. I certainly, and Steve knows this, have never disrespected anybody in the counterculture. I think the counterculture has done a lot of wonderful things in the United States. I think marijuana should not be made legal for the simple reason we will have far more users if we legalize it. We have 14 million users of marijuana in the United States. We have 170 million users of alcohol. Those two figures do not fall out that way by accident. Most people on Steve's side of the argument say if we legalize marijuana, we'll have between 5 and 10 times more users. Well, what? What are the effects of that? How do you weigh that against what is the real issue, which is recreational use of another drug? I believe four things would happen that are negative consequences because they're caused by marijuana. First of all, we would clearly have a heck of a lot more accidents, people being killed on the highway, at work, et cetera, et cetera. One of the reasons why medical marijuana is perceived good is for a disease called glaucoma. One of the arguments he'll use, it's good for glaucoma. Why is medical marijuana potentially good for glaucoma? Because it lessens the pressure on the optic nerve. Here's the pressure problem, guys. Most of you don't have glaucoma. So if you smoke marijuana, it still lessens the pressure on the optic nerve. It affects your depth perception. Ergo, more accidents. Let me read from a right-wing fundamentalist website. I took this off their website 2 weeks ago. Let me give you a quote. Quote, the responsible marijuana user does not operate a motor vehicle after smoking marijuana because it may contribute to serious accidents. What crazy right-wing organization said that? That's off the website of NORML, National Organization Reform of Marijuana Laws, the number one advocates in the United States for legalization of marijuana. They say it'll cause accidents if you smoke it. The second reason I don't believe we should legalize marijuana, or the second effect, would be we would have a lot more dependents. A lot of people who smoke grass do become dependent on it. Last year, 160,000 adolescents self-referred for marijuana dependence. They weren't busted by the cops, they weren't caught on urine tests, they self-referred. Now I know all of you know people who can smoke marijuana their whole life and never have a problem with it. Steve and I were on a TV show about a year ago, and a guy stood up in the audience, I'll never forget what he said. He looked right at me, and he said, I've been smoking marijuana every day of my life for the past 30 years, and I can quit anytime I want. Duh, why have I seen that movie about 1,000 times over the past 20 years? For some people, it causes dependence. The third reason is marijuana interferes with some people's ability to rationally think, study, and learn. About a year ago, a group called the American Academy of Pediatrics was writing a paper, all physicians, in favor of legalization of marijuana. They had voted in favor of legalization of medicinal marijuana. After they spent 2 years looking at all the research, the American Academy of Pediatrics wrote a paper in which they said marijuana has negative effects on short-term memory, concentration, attention span, motivation, and the ability to solve problems. They then reversed their decision. Smoking marijuana when you are in your lifestyle of learning, etc., is not good for you. And the final reason, and by far to me the most important reason, is personal. My sister died of breast cancer at age 42. I was with her the day she was diagnosed, and I hope this never happens to anybody in this room. But if you ever meet somebody that has a terrible disease like cancer, the reaction when they find out is usually the same. It's what my sister said. She looked at me and said, why me? Why did I get this terrible disease? And the problem I have with marijuana is very simply that a lot of people who smoke it indeed may be leading to a disease called lung cancer, where the gestation period is 20 years. Recently, the British Journal of Pharmacology published a study in which they said, quote, smoking marijuana is 5 times more carcinogenic and contains 4 times more TARS than smoking tobacco. The director of the Mayo Clinic Cancer Research Laboratory recently broke, quote, many people think marijuana is harmless. It is not. The carcinogens in marijuana are much more stronger than those in smoking tobacco. Now, by the way, should this be a surprise to anybody? I don't think so. How do you smoke tobacco? Right? Is that how you smoke a marijuana cigarette? Of course not. You take as much smoke in your lungs, hold it as deep in there for as long as you can. Now, guess what, guys? You do that for about 20 years. These studies show it indeed may cause lung, throat, and mouth cancer. And the problem with disease, when I look out at a group of young adults like you, bright, articulate young people, on the beginning of their lives, unfortunately, 20 to 25 years from now, the gestation period for lung cancer, if you don't believe me, just look at Peter Jennings, quit 25 years smoking tobacco before he got it. Unfortunately, some of you, if these research is right, will develop a disease like lung cancer 20 years from now and say, why me? Now, guys, I got to tell you the truth. I'm not God. I don't know if these studies are right, or I don't know if Steve's right. But I know damn sure the following. Before I take a chance of developing a disease like lung cancer, I'm going to learn all I can rationally about it. Here's the problem with Steve's argument. How do you change public policy in the United States? You guys are all bright young people. This is a public policy issue. How do you change public policy in the United States? One of three ways. You get the majority of the American people to agree with you. You voted in. It's a great part about this country. We can put in policies we want. The problem with Steve's argument is the American people don't agree with him. The highest number of people to ever agree with him that recreational marijuana use should be approved is 32%. It was on the ballot in 8 states over the past 4 years, recreational marijuana use. You know how many states it passed in? 0. Not one of the 8. The day the majority of American public wants marijuana made legal, I think we should legalize it. Second way we make change public policy is you attack the law in the courts. If you believe it is called tyranny by the majority, you attack the law in the courts. That's how Dr. King and his followers changed the segregation laws in the United States. We didn't change segregation laws in this country because one day everybody in Mississippi, Alabama, etc. woke up and said, we should do away with segregation. What happened? Dr. King attacked the laws in the federal courts as tyranny by the majority, and the courts overturned them. We have the right to do the same thing with marijuana. My challenge to Steve is, the day the court says we should reverse those laws, I do believe they should be reversed. And finally, of course, we allow medicine to become medicine, having scientists make the decision. My challenge to my friend Steve is, anytime one of those three things happen, I will be the first one to say we should legalize it. But don't stand there up and tell me that I know the public disagrees with me, I know the courts disagree with me, and I know that the scientific community disagrees with me, but we're going to change it anyway. The problem with my friend Steve is something many of you will learn when you go to law school. If some of you go to law school, you will take a class called litigation. And one of the first things you learn in litigation is something I'll never forget. If you're a good lawyer, they teach you, if the law is on your side, argue the law. If the facts are on your side, argue the facts. If nothing is on your side, just keep arguing. And that's what Steve will do. He will call my science gutter science. He will tell you the American people are stupid because they don't agree with him. And he will tell you the courts are inherently biased. My challenge to Steve is, make those people change their mind, and I will be the first one backing him up. But don't stand there like a petulant five-year-old and tell me, we're going to do it anyway, no matter what anybody thinks. That's not how we change public policy in this country. Thank you.
All right.